see from the invitation we have from Russia, Mikhail Kasyanov, former Prime Minister and also the chairman of the PARNAS party in Russia. Lilia Shevtsova, who we know from many times in Sweden in different capacities, is now associate of the Russia-Eurasia program at Chatham House. Mm-hmm. And then Ilya Ponomarev.
Ponomarev.
Who is a former member of the State Duma. If I understand you correctly, you are actually a member of the Duma, but you are not allowed to enter into Russia.
tricky proposition.
And by the way, Ilya was the only member of State Duma that were against the annexation of Karin, which I think takes a lot of courage. I think you should be peaceful. And Karin Enström, she is the deputy chair of the Committee on Foreign Affairs in Swedish Parliament, very important position. I was one of them. And then, last but not least, Stephen Nix, who comes from the IRI, and he is the Eurasia director of the International Republic. He is the one, I would say, in the West that knows most about the easternmost Ukraine, Russia, Moldova.
Just another Washington attorney, going. But thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Goran. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for joining us this evening for a very important discussion, the status of Russia in terms of democratization. There are so many challenges around the world. Sometimes the challenge of Russia gets lost, but it's important for us to meet and gather and to discuss this strategic and integral issue. Our thanks go out to the Hjalmarson Foundation for hosting this event. Thank you, Goran. Thank you, Eva, for putting all of this together. We've had a number of discussions today related to Russia, and we will continue. As for myself and my organization, for those of you who are not acquainted with the International Republican Institute, we are a democracy promotion organization in Washington, D.C. We work in over 60 countries. We were founded by President Ronald Reagan, and we've been chaired for the last 20 years by Senator John McCain. But we're really here today to hear from a very talented and distinguished panel. And you're very fortunate to hear from people who have expertise in a broad range of issues, from political to diplomatic to military to energy, represented at this table today. But we will first start with the former Prime Minister, Mr. Kasyanov, who led, along with the late Boris Nemtsov, the creation of the PARNAS political party. Political Association continues in that role today, and we will have him start off with the program, and then we'll go then to Ilya Ponomarev, then to Karin, and then finally to Lilia. So, Mikhail Mikhailovich, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Stephen. Good evening, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great pleasure for me and honor to be here in Stockholm this day with you, and to share my views on the current situation in Russia and potential prospects. Of course, all of us, we have many, many questions. What will happen with my country soon, or just in the foreseeable future? Not all answers for all questions we have, but I think just the general discussion is absolutely important, and I'm very happy that you have such an interest to what's going on in Russia, in our country, and that you're involved in those discussions. And of course, we, as a, I believe, many of us Russians believe, we are as an integral part of Europe, of course, should be close and should share our views with our friends here. Let me start with answering, Simon, for your statement. As you said, many of us think already that we lost Russia. Some people in Russia would also think this way, but I believe we haven't lost it yet, because of the simple reason that the free people or people devoted to democratic principles, people who believe that Russia deserved to be a normal democratic state, as a normal European democratic state. We exist, we continue to be in our country, we continue to fight for our prosperous future. We have our constitution, which designed as a constitution of a democratic state, but unfortunately none of the position described in the constitution implemented by current authorities in practice. We don't have separation of power, we don't have independent judiciary, we don't have free media, and we don't have the most important thing, just free and fair elections. You know that we face with many problems, and especially with the regime led by Vladimir Putin. We're already at peak to be in a self-isolation because of wrong and deliberate decision of authorities, Russian authorities. But we all believe that democratic transformation possible, and democratic transformation would be a good chance for Mr. Putin to start liberalization of whole life. And in particular, we wanted and believed that last parliamentary elections, which took place in September, would be a good chance for Mr. Putin somehow to start gradually start changes and gradually to build up an exit strategy for himself and his team. But it appeared to be not the case. You know, for us, for PARNAS, who for the first time participated in the parliamentary elections, because we knew young liberal central-right party, we for 10 years tried to get access to elections, but Putin always denied on political grounds registration, but registration, that's the access to elections in our country. But as a result of our appeal to European Court of Human Rights, we got a ruling in our favor, and Putin at that time, 3 years ago, was not in a position to implement the decision of European Court of Human Rights, and we got registration and access to elections. We participated in these elections, and with the independent sociological poll, which was in September prior to voting day, we got a rating like 8.59%, but appeared to be zero in official figures. Even communists were surprised because just they always have a different regions in Russia. We have so-called just Russian bridge or communist bridges around Moscow or other districts, other areas, regions of Russia where communists have like 20% support. But in other regions, they have 5% support, or even lower than 3. But they got everywhere 14%. And they were saying, huh, why 14? But for every region in Russia, 14%. That was for the first time, that was not just falsification. It was the elections with the result without any connection between the polling station and the protocols as a result of that. No chance was used by Mr. Putin for gradual transformation. We are heading further on. Very difficult way, and squeezing on the whole environment, civil society environment, continue to take place. Our activists, from time to time, individually, under criminal investigation, got, jail, position in jail. And recently we had another case when one of our activists simply was protesting with individual protest, which is absolutely free without any permission and a note in accordance with the Constitution. For 3 times of doing this, he was given 3 years of detention. Now he's in jail. It's absolutely already the environment when individual repression started to be an instrument of dealing with opposition. Yes, we should admit that Putin managed to build up quite a stable system based on results of propaganda. 50% of Russians continue to be people getting information from one source, central television. We continue to be a TV set country. Despite of the fact that internet is quite widely spread in Russia, and the speed of spreading of internet is growing. 2 years ago, it was 50 million people using internet. This year, already 66 million people using internet. But despite of that, that Putin managed to keep control over the whole information environment. That is the basis of the stability of the regime. But these days, the stability is under question because of the very evident issue that economic crisis already came in. Already for the second year in a row, the families revenues declined by 10% per year, and GDP shrinking last year by 5%, this year 2%, and no single expert in economy in Russia or abroad project for Russia economic growth with the rate of 5 or 6 or whatever 7%, and it was when I was prime minister at that time. And that time we managed through economic reform to create a basis for growth, and within 5 year period we got 40% growth of GDP, and another following 5 years, another 40% growth of GDP. And my time, the oil price was $25 per barrel. During the previous 10 years, it was $100 per barrel, but the economic growth was 2%, and the last 2 years, stagnation, decline, and now stagnation. And I'd like to emphasize by that we, having this regime in power, we don't have any reason to believe that economic growth could be restored, because of the simple reason, the trust between this state and investors destroyed completely. No single investor in Russia or outside Russia now is prepared to invest in the Russian economy because of simple explanation of what's going on, pressure of secret services and police, because of redistribution of property, and private property is questioned every day. That is the basic issue which gives opportunity for investors to start thinking about that. That's why I'd like to emphasize that we're coming to the very sensitive period when, additionally to economic crisis, we already have a crisis of society. Crisis of society. Today we discussed the recent sociological poll where it was described that 53% of population now answering the question where Russia is heading to. And the answer is 53% heading in the wrong direction. It means that the general popular support of Mr. Putin is going down, despite of the report says 85, whatever, 90% support. He still has huge support, like a little bit less, at my estimation, or 50%, but it's a lot. It's a lot to keep power and to continue to build up on that. Last years, we watch how Putin already appeared to be in totality authoritarian regime, authoritarian of this particular person, and to keep legitimacy, losing legitimacy inside Russia, to keep legitimacy in general, he had to raise it abroad. And as always it happened for authoritarian regime, you need external power and internal power. And external enemy, external enemy was easily found. That's the United States in particular, and NATO in principle. Now just European Union as general also appeared to be as enemy. And internal enemy, that's the so-called fifth column, us, opposition. We pressed every day, we blackmailed every day, and we're under pressure. You know, just I don't want to even to recall that my friend and close political partner Boris Nemtsov was killed just on the front of Kremlin, 100 meters from the Kremlin wall. Many people put in jail. We got 16 people in jail. And still, they started already getting out, spending there 3-4 years. But that's a payment for being independent for all those years and continue to criticize. We organized all those rallies in Moscow against the previous falsification on elections, against the aggression in Ukraine, against of annexation of Crimea and other things. And we're just a real enemy for this regime. Whether the stability will continue, that's what we have to discuss today. I think just all those challenges what we have, not only in Russia, but outside and in the United States recently in particular, create some kind of other challenges and additional questions we have to find answers. And we are prepared to discuss it today. Thank you.
Thank you, Mikhail, for that presentation. And we will now go to Ilya Ponomarev. You have the floor.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you all for coming. It's really a great opportunity to meet you and talk to you. I'd like to focus a little bit more on why we hear those figures of 85% support of Putin. Where are they coming from? We have this argument with Mikhail, you know, to the degree of how many actually do support Putin. Some say it would be 50%, some say it would be 70%, some say it would be 85%. Nevertheless, it's a large number. And indeed, all the sociologists report in Russia that people are dissatisfied with the government policies, that they don't like, and that's official pollsters, not opposition pollsters. Officially, it's well known that people don't like the direction the country is going in terms of economic sphere. And despite that, the reports of those 80%. What's the reason? The reason, I think, is lying in the whole system that was created in Russia for last 25 years. And we should understand that for Russians, there is no much of a difference between, for example, Yeltsin and Putin. After the collapse of the Soviet Union, it's post-Soviet system, and people basically see that as one system. And indeed, if we look at the general economic policy of the government, we would see that this would be more or less the same slogans that government is offering to the society. Free market, competition, privatization, market economy. The implementation is different, of course. And one story was happening in the 90s during the active phase of privatization campaign. There was a different strategy that was implemented during short reign of we can say it as a social democratic government of Yevgeny Primakov in 1999 after probably the biggest economic crisis in Russia in 98 during Mikhail Kasyanov's time. And then the current government that we see under Medvedev. But generally, people are more or less the same, especially economic block of the government is the same. And we identify those people as system liberals, which basically say more or less the same things about how the economy should be managed. And the practices that are being implemented are more or less the same. It's introducing as much market principles in the social spheres and giving as much property in the hands of trusted people, whoever they are under different different governments. People don't like it. And they never did. And the level of frustration was growing every year during the whole of 25 years. And what happened in 2014, Putin basically offered people certain replacement for their frustration. He said, okay, yeah, maybe we are not as good inside the country, and maybe we are corrupt, and you guys are poor, but let's try to restore Soviet Union. And that's what was the message that was propagated within the country during the annexation of Crimea. Of course, it was not in these words that I say, but that's how many people took it. And Soviet Union was a very complex phenomenon for different people that meant a very different thing. For some people, that was a country of social justice. For some people, it was a great empire. And those who were thinking about Soviet Union as a country of social justice, this aggression in Ukraine generated hope that maybe we are expanding, maybe we are going back to the same principles of the past. For those who are for empire, that's exactly what we are doing, reconquering the land and restoring Russian empire. And I think that's the origin of the numbers that we see right now. And in the situation when people are deeply alienated from the power itself, and we see that this gap between ordinary people and the government is growing constantly every year, they see this process as the possibility to somehow influence and the hope for the change. They tend to believe in what they want to believe. The perfect example of this is this horrible tragedy with the shot MH17 airplane. It looks like all the evidence is showing that it was shot with a Russian missile. And I think that the only dispute which we may have is whether it was a Russian soldier who pressed the button, or it was a separatist from the so-called Donetsk People's Republic, who was the operator of the particular launcher. But that the origin of the launcher was in Russia, and that it was supplied from Russia, and that it was that particular launcher, it's now obvious. All the evidence is right there. Nevertheless, this truth is extremely uncomfortable for people. People don't want to acknowledge this, and they try to create a whole set of conspiracy theories, like it was the same missing airplane that Malaysian Airlines lost half a year before that in Indian Ocean, that all the people were dead already by the time it was shot down, that it was shot by Ukrainian fighter jet, despite that this fighter jet technically cannot reach the ceiling and shoot the particular airplane. And I remember my youth in 1983 when we shot Karin 007 airliner over Sakhalin Island, and I remember how we were discussing that, okay, so maybe we shot down that plane, but what if it would be a nuclear bomb on that airplane, or whether it was really a spy airplane, etc., etc. So we created a lot of theories why it was the right thing to do. And that's what's happening right now in Russia once again. There was one particular survey where people were asked whether it's a Russian military which are fighting in eastern Ukraine, the fact that our government is denying all the time. And it was actually pretty large part of audience, like 50% of responders, who said, yes, it's us who are fighting there, but we should keep it as a secret. Because it is the right thing to do. That we are liberating our brother Ukrainians. That it's fascists, it's junta in Kyiv, and we are on the right side of history. And that's what people are comfortable with. And we should understand this. This is something that people create for themselves. This alternative reality. That is the reason why propaganda on the TV is so efficient. It was not efficient in the middle of 90s when we were fighting in Chechnya and public opinion was opposing that war. because it was more comfortable for people to oppose that war. We don't like Chechens. We don't think that they like they're part of our culture. So let them go. And they didn't want our children, our neighbors, our brothers to die in Chechnya fighting for something that people don't understand. In reverse, right now with Donbas, maybe it's not on the top of the priorities, but still we think that we are doing the right thing, and that's why we are even ready to be okay with all the casualties that are happening there, and there are there are several thousand people who already died in this conflict from the Russian side, and several tens of thousands of civilians that died from Ukrainian side. But still people think that we are on the right side of the history. And that's the biggest problem and the biggest strategy that my country is experiencing right now. What to do? I think that the Russian opposition, Russian society is right now facing a certain dead end. We cannot continue as it is right now. And that has been even admitted by the government. Just recently, they changed political leadership in Kremlin, despite the fact that it looks like it was a triumph at parliamentary elections, and United Russia won a constitutional majority. So political managers like Vyacheslav Volodin were supposed to be rewarded for this. But they instead were removed from their positions. And why is that? I think that the main problem is in dramatic fall of a turnout for the elections. Yeah. We should understand that currently 75% of the parliament, actually 76 even, are being voted for by 25% of the population, even according to official numbers, with all the falsifications and everything. And the actual number is most likely is around 15-16% of the population. Yeah, technically it is a victory, but Kremlin do understand the value of this victory. And the main objective that administration right now is receiving for upcoming presidential elections is turnout. That whether it would be Putin or whether it would not be Putin, but it has to be a mobilization within the society. It has to be a link with the majority of people. Majority of people should come and vote. And this lack of trust from the people's side for the political system is not only about the pro-government forces, it's also about the opposition. The biggest drop in the voting was in Moscow and in St. Petersburg, which are known to be the opposition strongholds, and people could have come and voted for Yabloko and PARNAS, and well, at least Yabloko, I think, should be in the in Duma. It was enough constituents to vote for them, obviously, but it didn't happen. People don't trust the opposition as much as they don't trust the government. The opposition has to be reinvented. Right now, we are in a desperate search of a new idea, of a new platform, of a new approach, of a new technology, how to connect with voters and how to convince them that there is a vision. I think that the main strategy of the power right now is actually to strip people from the alternative. The message that Kremlin is sending to the society is not that they are the best. Actually, they never say that they are clean and uncorrupt. They say, yes, you know, in Russia everybody was corrupt for ages. We are maybe not the smartest, we are not the best, we are not the cleanest. But look at those guys in the opposition, they are worse than us. They are also as corrupt, they are also as bad. They also don't have any vision, And we, the Kremlin, we at least offer you stability. And they are calling the society to go backwards in 90s and to all the problems and whatever. And this is very heavily linked with the Western influence. In recent year, the vector of state propaganda on our TV has changed. If 1 year ago they were describing Ukrainians as fascists and junta and whatever, and that we are fighting against junta, now we are fighting against liberals who are governing Ukraine and who is with the conjunction with IMF advice, World Bank, Americans and whatever, making Ukrainians poor. And the message is, do you want to go back to the situation when you are poor, back to the situation when the country is in chaos? Then restore what they call Western democracy. And then you will be poor again, then you will be in chaos again, etc., etc., etc. So I think that the answer that we may give and what we should give is a positive alternative, the positive alternative which Kremlin cannot contest. And extremely important that we together with the West, and I totally agree with Mikhail that of course Russia is part of the West, and it's not, we are not Chinese just looking at the mirror. We are part of Western civilization, of a civilization of enlightenment, that we need to create a success story. And this success story is right next to our borders in Ukraine. It should be a success story. If it will be a success story, then I think Russia would start to change. And I am sure that that would happen one day. Thank you.
Thank you, Ilya, for that insight. We now turn to more of a Swedish perspective. We have Karin, who has served her country in the military, served in the executive branch of government, served in the legislative branch of government. What's the Swedish take on the situation with Russia?
Thank you, and thank you all for being here, and thank you to the Jarl Hjalmarson Foundation for arranging this seminar, and it's wonderful to be a part of this panel. Of course, my view now, my perspective will be more of a Swedish one. And just to start and to state the obvious, that the illegal annexation of Crimea and the following intervention of regular units of the Russian army in the easternmost Ukraine have created a long-term crisis with severe consequences, not just for Ukraine, but for I would say, for international peace and security. And the way I see it, Russia's action here are more of an evidence that there is really an ambition of becoming a great power again, and as you said, trying to find an external enemy to get, well, make people forget what's happening domestically. And in both Ukraine and now in Syria, we can see the results of Russia's increased military spending and its increased capacity. And as I see it, Russia really wants to send a signal that it means business. It's here to stay, and it has, I would say, a natural place on the world scene, on the global scene, and it's also willing to take risks. So that's my take. We hoped, of course. I think whole Sweden and the whole, I would talk for, speak for I would say all the political parties in Sweden, that we really hoped and we still hope for a more modern and open Russia, of course. But the political development that we have seen has taken another course. And I would say that the financial crisis 2008 exposed the limits of President Putin's model of governance. And the mass protests in 2012 in connection to the presidential election and the lowered level of trust in the government demonstrated that the Russians wanted something else, at that time at least. But what we see now is increased tension in the Baltic Sea, and I would say as that is partly President Putin's response to the discontent of the Russian people, and also then coming to Ukraine. And since Russia's action in Ukraine, Sweden and our neighbors have seen increased military activity in the Baltic Sea, and the two corvettes armed with long-range nuclear capable cruise missiles that entered the Baltic Sea in October, they are the latest example of these activities that have really, I would say, heightened the tensions in our region. We've seen this for a couple of years, but I must say this last year it has even increased more. We have the foreign submarine activity confirmed in the Stockholm Archipelago. That was already in 2014. And if you read the Swedish Security Service's report from last year, 2015, they state that there is an ongoing intelligence threat from Russia, amongst others, but that Russia is trying to influence the Swedish debate, on security policy through disinformation. And we have never seen that stated so clear in a report. And adding to that, the Russian rhetoric on nuclear weapons has reached a level unthinkable even during the Cold War, I would say. Using it during its exercises and training, and also showing that, well, we are ready to use it. Why not? It's not something unthinkable anymore, and that is really, really worrying. So from the Swedish perspective, we really have to evaluate every option at hand. We have to continue to strengthen our own military defense, but also strengthen the other kind of total defense, since it's not just a question of military business here, but it's extremely important. And we have to continue and to deepen our security and defense policy cooperation, especially in the Baltic Sea region with our Nordic neighbors, with our Baltic neighbors, with the EU and with NATO. And we really have to analyze this in depth. So apart from increased international cooperation, we have to, as I said, look into our own capabilities as well. And facing these challenges, it's important that we have a unified message. I think we have to be very firm, not just from the Nordic countries, but also, of course, if EU can keep its unity, preferably together with the US, then I think there is a chance that we can see a change. If we start to back down, I think we are in a even more dangerous situation than we are right now. And I must admit that as close as we are, the Nordic countries, we do have a little bit of different, how can I say, our point of departure is a little bit different. We have we don't have the similar, security policy affiliations, as you know. Sweden and Finland being not military aligned, not members of NATO. Denmark and Norway are members. Norway is not a member of the EU. So there are many differences. On the other hand, we share a lot of the same values. We don't share the exact geopolitical situation, since Finland has its very long border with Russia. From a Swedish perspective, we are a little bit off, and usually in Sweden we talk a lot about Russia, but not with Russia. And of course, we have to have some kind of dialogue. But at this moment, it's really, really difficult to see on which topics then. Mm-hmm. Not just to have a dialogue for its own sake. And just to you know all this, I know this is a distinguished listeners here. We have for a long time had this partnership for peace. We are a partner to NATO. But these days, and especially the crisis, not just the crisis, the illegal annexation of Crimea and the aggression in eastern Ukraine has really shown that there's a difference between being a partner and a member of the alliance. And of course, I would like to see a Swedish membership. I think that's one of the ways to, in the near future, strengthen our security, and preferably do this together with Finland. As I said in the beginning, in my introduction, to have a unified European Union is extremely important. And there has been many crises in the EU since 2008. I think we've been in constant crisis management since 2008. But one thing we have succeeded with, and that is the unity, even if sometimes debated, but regarding the sanctions towards Russia. And I think it's extremely important that we can keep this unity. We have to consider further sanctions. And now, with the new president-elect in the US, we must do everything we can to find some kind of unity to keep the pressure. Because when we start to back off, I think we have an even more dangerous situation, as I said. And this also applies on energy. We've been discussing here in Sweden the Nord Stream 2. Another pipeline, which we see as a way of making Europe or EU even more dependent on Russian gas. And we think it's totally counterproductive. It does not meet the goals of the energy union, and it has the risk of really making European countries even more dependent on Russian gas. And that is not what we need right now. So I think that would be a mistake, and I hope that the EU can be very clear and united regarding this. And just a couple of words on what we've been talking about here. How does it look? What are the conditions for the opposition? Some people have told me that, well, there's no real opposition in Russia. There are people, individuals, but there is no collective opposition. And of course, that is a problem, because the space for an opposition is not there anymore. And this is, of course, extremely worrying. And we try in Sweden to find ways then, what can we do to be supportive? But it's nowadays we speak about shrinking spaces. And I would say in Russia, the spaces for civil society, for a different view on anything is making it really, really difficult for us to do something. But we have to find means. So to sum up, I'm not too optimistic. On the other hand, we cannot give up. We have to find ways, both to be very firm, to keep an external pressure, but of course also try to then to promote the good forces that I'm sure do still exist in Russia. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Karin, for your presentation. I could not agree more that unity within the EU is essential with regard to Russia, and certainly unity between the United States and the European Union, absolutely essential when it comes to policy towards Russia. That leads us to our final speaker, who we will ask Lilia now to take some of the component parts and help to summarize our discussion today. Lilia, the floor is yours.
Well, Steve, definitely I cannot summarize. Well, now I will be admitting probably, something just opposite. After listening to our panel, I decided that it's time to me to be a little bit more emotional, but not structured. I will share with you my headache, and I will admit my helplessness. Because it seems to me that for me, an old conference horse on the expert scene, that has been for ages, it seems to me for ages, I've been trying to formulate Russia's logic. Can you imagine such an ambitious agenda? And at some moments, yes, definitely, you know, at night, sleepless nights, I was just coming to conclusion, oh, just it's written on the wall. There are the trends. Yes, these are the trends. I'm right. And these are the challenges. And here are on the ceilings the tipping points. I got it. And in the morning, you know, the events just kicked over the chessboard. And again, I was starting from the scratch. Now I'm explaining my helplessness by one conclusion, that it seems to me, and this is maybe not a very academic or scientific conclusion, that it seems to me that we are dealing with drama of the civilization that is too tight. You know, there are some cases in history when nations and states and societies get too tight, lose some willpower, some drive. It happened to some countries in the 20th century. And in this situation, civilizations get stuck in the historical space. But our drama is not the fact that we got stuck. Our drama is joint drama with you folks. Why? Because we got stuck in the situation when the most progressive civilization in the world, liberal democracies, lost its drive, mission, and trajectory. So in this situation, you know, our future is pretty hopeless. And only 4 points, very briefly, and my answer to Karin's question about the space for opposition. Firstly, and this is already a kind of nagging issue for me, the issue of repentance. I'm talking about myself. I belong to the academic expert community in Moscow, despite my affiliation with the absolutely wonderful institution, the Chatham House. So we all experts, analysts, observers, and maybe some people even from the political world, need some kind of repentance because we need to reassess quite a few axioms, stereotypes, conclusions, beliefs that we cherished during the last at least 25 years, at least after the collapse of the Soviet Union. And we need to dustbin quite a few books on Yeltsin's liberal reforms, on partnership and modernization, on, you know, cooperation with the West, on reset, etc., etc., etc. We need to make a reassessment. And without returning to the past, hardly we could understand the present. Secondly, on uniqueness. Well, so many times, you know, we all have been mentioning about Russia's uniqueness, but definitely, just could you find any example in the modern history when petrostate is at the same time nuclear power and superpower too, and at the same time, half-frozen, half-collapsed empire that is having its own helix in the former Soviet space and is harassing the world order, undermining the world order? Do you have any example? Of course, this is the unique construct. And not a single communist or post-communist model could be useful here. And have you ever seen the system that belongs to the 16th century that is in such a cynical and predatory an effective and astute way is using 21st technology? Just have a look at the American media during the campaign. And have you ever seen the system that is preserving and reproducing its status quo by undermining the global rules of the game? Hmm? Ever saw that? Yes, uniqueness. Third point on foreign policy. It's also a very interesting thing to observe. Foreign policy. Foreign policy became the Russia's salvation, the Kremlin's salvation. foreign policy became the very important instrument of survival of our system, servant of Russia's domestic agenda. And when I'm reading books, essays of my colleagues, well, I wrote it myself. I made so many mistakes. I have to dustbin myself too, about Russia's confrontation with the West. There is absolutely no idea of Russia's confrontation with the West. Nobody wants it. Everybody is afraid of it. The Kremlin, come on, they're not kamikaze. They do not have any kind of suicidal instincts, and they fear confrontation, and they fear the repetition of the Cold War, and they know that it will never happen because Cold War confrontation never happened in the world of globalization. It's just impossible. It's impossible. So what would they like? What is the agenda, if not confrontation? The agenda is very simple: to force you folks to date, to force you folks to love us, to force you folks to marry us. Yes, we are buzzing the air carriers. Yes, maybe there are even some submarines in the Swedish territorial waters. I don't know, allegedly. Well, but this is the way to force you to accept the Kremlin's rules of the game. And my hunch is, and I would argue, that at least most of these demands have been accepted, including by the only sleeping superpower that has just elected a very interesting president. And the final issue, the issue of impediments. Why we have this kind of pathetic situation that, you know, makes a great professor of history constantly challenge us, at least me. We are in the constant, you know, tug of war, Richard Pipes, who is writing one book after another, trying to persuade himself and the world that Russians are genetically, you know, we are genetically such as we are. We love subjugation. We love when someone is whacking us down. We are just incorrigible, okay? Yes, of course we have impediments, but these impediments, we don't know what to do with them, but at least we understand them. And the major impediment is not our position. It's the liberal gangsters, let's put it this way. Liberal gangsters in the government, because this kind of system that we have in Russia, it's been sustained and it still limps along on crutches, but it limps along, not because the power ministries are supporting it, but because liberals are serving its needs and agenda. Without liberals in the central bank and the government, it would have never, ever, ever frightened you folks, liberals. And when liberals are supporting the 16th century system, there is no place, possibility for any liberal reform, isn't it? And then, of course, I have to admit that we have fear. I wonder whether my colleagues have fear. Well, maybe we have different fears and nightmares, but there is one nightmare that is really substantial, very serious, and very dramatic. And this fear is that if we start to open the windows and doors like we did in 1991, we would face again the collapse of the state, because such a kind of state, how it could be kept together? And you know, I'm not sure that we are ready again for the collapse of the state, and I'm not sure that you folks are ready for the collapse of the state with so many nukes and Iskanders. So. And thirdly, for me, it's most important thing, at least at this kind of discussion, here and outside Stockholm, just could you answer the question yourself? Is it possible to transform Russia to make it liberal democracy? Is it possible when liberal democracy has lost itself and its normative dimension, is paralyzed and is suffocating? And when liberal democracy is part, you know, of the service system of the Russian rentier class, I'm not talking only about Schroeder, I'm talking about so hundreds and thousands of people in the West that in fact support our system. It's their support system, it's their crutches. And about the space for opposition, Karin. I'm not sure that you need to create space for these guys, for opposition. I'm not sure. And in any case, you will never be able to do that. But you are absolutely able, capable, to do something else for us, to limit the space for the Russian rentier class inside of your own society, when you'll be practicing what you preach. Is it too idealistic, huh? Thank you.
Thank you, Lilia. Thank you for bringing us down to earth and setting the stage for possible elevation. But thank you for that presentation. Now, you've heard from the panel. We want to interact with you. So we will go into question and answer session. The Hjalmarson Foundation staff have microphones. We would ask that that you stand, use the microphone, if you could identify yourself and the organization that you represent, and if there is a specific panel member that you would like to direct your question to. So who has questions? Yes, this gentleman straight in the back. Давай микрофон. Ага. Please.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Joel Albert from the Swedish Folke Bernadotte Academy. I heard that the second telephone call that the president-elect in the U.S. Received from the foreign leader was from Vladimir Putin. And allegedly the agenda was Syria. My question is why this concern, or why does what's the issue, and why was the Syrian issue the most important topic in this conversation?
Are you directing your question at Mr. Kasyanov or so? Oh, okay.
The question of the Syria crisis, it was also the questions how they will together fight against terrorism. And we must to look now in the wider perspective what it will going on in the world. You know, everything has changed with the American presidential election. And everybody must to take that fact.
Thank you. But we're going to answer the gentleman's question.
Let me answer just the exact question first, and then we can, of course, have the philosophical discussion about just what transformation we could face with because of those changes in the United States. Syria, of course, I'd like to understand just what the president-elect would look first, what are the first priorities. And his first interview, he already mentioned that internal affairs like health system and other things, just like energy, would be priority number one. And of course, Syria, that's one of the challenges which United States is facing with. And Ukraine is a second problem too, and that's why just absolutely evident that the fight around Aleppo, which could be the point for Mr. Putin just to have a small victory, that's absolutely necessary for Mr. Putin. But for new president, that's absolutely clear that he's under pressure of Congress and the whole American society, just what to do with the Syrian people. Just people continue to die. And that's why I think that's absolutely without any surprise for me that the Syria issue was a priority in their discussion. What the consensus could be, if any, I think it's difficult to imagine that, for instance, President Trump would accept Putin's desire to recognize, so that the whole world to recognize Bashar Assad as legitimate president. But that's the only what Putin wants. Of course, the fight against terrorism, that joint responsibility. Russia is a permanent member of Security Council. United States is permanent member of Security Council. That's our responsibility, global responsibility, to have to settle all those problems. But the only dispute is Assad, who applied the chemical weapons against the population. The whole United Nations just recognized Assad as a criminal person. Putin continued to insist he's a legitimate president. Putin doesn't want to continue this role of those dictators dismissed like Gaddafi, Hussein and others. That's why for him that is a frontier, that's the front line. That's why he's so consistent in defending, because he's afraid who will be next. That's why I think that's a crucial point. I don't believe that President Trump would accept Putin's demand or desire or request just to recognize Assad, and then just we will join, as it was Al-Qaeda in 2001, 2002. When we were together in the international coalition fighting in Afghanistan with Al-Qaeda. I don't think now that would be possible. I don't think Putin would sell out Assad and then everything would be settled. We'll see. We'll see what will happen after inauguration and forming a new government in the United States.
Karin.
Thank you. Well, I'm not worried about the fact that a conversation has taken place, but I'm more worried about since we have this uncertainty and that the president-elect in the US seems to be so unpredictable, then I am more afraid of what could that, well, shape or create in President Putin's mind, that he's trying to test this guy, to test him, or try to just, well, make something up and see what's going to happen, what would be the reaction. So that's my first worry. And the other worry is, of course, there's been talks about, well the president, the two presidents making some kind of a deal. And that would be one of the worst scenarios for a small country like Sweden. We are dependent on a kind of a world order with some kind of respect for international and humanitarian law. So we don't need deals and a bipolar world again.
Thank you. We have a question up front.
Just quickly, I think that we need to understand that Putin is not about acknowledging Assad as a legitimate president. Putin is about acknowledging himself as a legitimate leader of the world. That's the objective of all talks, and in Syria, he's fighting for himself and not for Assad. And I think that the answer how the phone call went is pretty much we can find today in the news when we see that there are airstrikes on Homs and Idlib. That's pretty much the answer how the phone call went. And my take in general on the issue of Trump, that would be a very difficult partner for Moscow. Way more difficult than Obama was. I think that they both are psychologically very much of the same breed. They both are bullish. And such person can sustain their supremacy only by making others stand on their knees. And that's what they both would try to achieve in the very near future. So I have pretty little doubt that one of the first meetings of Trump would be indeed with President Putin, and most likely they will try to make a deal, and obviously that would be a deal on Syria, but I don't see any single opportunity how the deal can be implemented and carried out and sustain half a year.
Okay, we've got a question here and then we'll go to you, sir. Yes, sir.
Pretty much the same question, but I'd like to move to another part of the world, the Baltic states. perceived Russia threat to the Baltic states, is, has that changed because of the election of President Trump? Will the Baltic states be part of that settlement or negotiations or whatever? Or is it the same game? What is the clear and present danger for the Baltic states from Russia?
Lilia? Ilya?
My question would be very close, so perhaps we could take that.
Of course. Yes, sir. Please.
In the same area. Johan Molander, I'm a retired diplomat. As you might know, there is rather new, since about 1.5 or 2 years ago, discussion in Sweden on possible NATO membership, which creates a divide also in the Swedish political sphere. Now, this discussion has been accompanied, as has been stated here, by an extremely aggressive Russian behavior in the Baltic against the Swedish coast, fake attacks, intelligence gathering in a very obvious way, etc., etc. Now, what is, if it is a Russian policy goal that Sweden not be a member of NATO, is this not a very counterproductive way of behaving, because it's been given ammunition to those of us who would favor a membership of NATO? Or is it just counting on that bullying enough will frighten the whatever out of the Swedes, so they won't even dare get into NATO? Very much like it was many years ago on the INF, when I had the feeling that the Soviet Union was trying to frighten Western Europe not to place mid-range missiles.
Thank you.
So I would like to hear our Russian friends give us an analysis of why this behavior, if they want to keep us out of NATO.
Sure. Let's go to Ilya and Lilia on the Baltics question, and then perhaps with Mikhail and both Karin for the NATO question.
Okay. So the first point, I think that the general logic of Russian regime is making inevitable the escalation and more confrontation with the West, because as soon as you stand on the path of aggression and escalation, you have to continue. You have to raise stakes, because the whole region, the whole reason, firstly for the annexation of Crimea, then for intervention of Donbas, then Syria, Turkey, was public opinion inside the country. The rest of considerations were secondary. To illustrate this fact, it's a very simple consideration. If Putin just wanted to take over Crimea, it would be way more reasonable, firstly, to make them run the referendum to separate from Ukraine, wait another year, and then take them over. But that didn't happen, and he was ready to pay the price for with the sanctions and with the confrontation with the West to actually make a direct aggression on the territory and annex that territory, and not follow already proven path of South Ossetia and Abkhazia, which went well and unpunished, right? It's all about internal audience. If it is about internal audience, then the logical next step, which we don't know when it will happen, but it should happen, it should be at one point confrontation with NATO. And I think that what is about to happen, Putin is not a military person, he is a secret operations guy. I think that he would create a case that would be sufficient for the victim to call for the application of Article 5, but which would not be sufficient for others, members of NATO, to grant this call. And that would be the end of the NATO. And I think that's the objective, is to defeat NATO and to declare the victory over NATO. In general, NATO generals right now are admitting openly in public talks that NATO is extremely weak on the eastern side of the alliance. And I am wondering, you know, the alliance, which was in the first place created to confront Soviet Union and to defend from the Soviet Union, if it is weak on the eastern side, then where it is strong? and what is the reason of NATO's existence. And I think that what President Trump is was saying many times in public, that's exactly the constatation of this precise fact, that NATO as an alliance is, has totally lost its momentum, and the whole existence of NATO means a lot of expense on behalf of the United States, but very little added value. The squadrons, those two squadrons altogether that is about to be sent to Eastern Europe, to Baltic states and to Poland, they will not make any difference in terms of military balance in the region. And of course that is not going to scare anyone more. It's rather a demonstration of weakness and importance of the alliance. And it's taken in Moscow exactly like this, and not as a real threat. So I genuinely expect that during Trump's presidency we will see more direct bilateral military interactions, rather than interactions in the framework of an alliance.
Well, very shortly, maybe I will just add to what Ilya has said. Firstly, of course, we are not naive. Different type of contingencies are always on the table. And only now we understand that Crimea contingency had been on the table for several years. This is firstly. Secondly, Ilya, I'm not sure that a lot depends. Well, I don't think that we should engage in Shrinkinology, Putinology, because a lot depends not on what the President Putin is thinking. We can only make guesses. But what is the logic of the military patriotism and military paradigm that is the only consolidating factor in Russia, okay? This is first, secondly. Thirdly, it seems to me that Russia is being seduced and the Russian political class is being lured into testing where the red line is by the West. You know, so far, the Kremlin, it seems to me, didn't encounter serious resistance in its search for the red line. And the next moment is you can always lose control over the testing of the red line. And the final thing is, it seems to me, the military limited, military NATO response for Russia's testing where the red line in the Baltic is just what the Kremlin would like to have. Because can you imagine if the West, instead of reviving NATO, would include the American Treasury Department into the game? That would be a fatal blow. But the West decided to play in the games. And Baltic states are part of the game.
Okay, thank you. Now to the NATO question. Yeah. Mikhail and then Karin.
Okay,
yes.
NATO. I think we should understand that Putin developed the story for himself and for all Russians, that Russia got some kind of promises from NATO not to be enlarged. And he said, we were promised, and right now the West behaves differently, doesn't implement given promises and obligations. That's absolutely the developed story. I talk to all, just President Gorbachev, President Yeltsin, President Putin, and I know well that there never such promises were given, neither to Soviet Union, nor to Russian presidents. That's why Putin, being the whole concept of external enemy, continue to aggravate this issue of NATO enlargement and just growing danger for Russia, creating the imposing mobilization spirit that we surrounded by enemies, and those Western enemies would like to deprive Russia on its sovereignty, to take our oil and gas, etc., etc., etc. That is the propaganda terms and sophisticated, I would say, approach how to treat Russian people in general terms, how to keep power. Right now, it just seems to be desire to keep power forever. That's why enlargement, that is one of those issues which absolutely every day in the process in the Russian media, in Russian propaganda. As to Sweden, I think it's very simple to decide whether in general terms you would like to be a part of this security system on the whole structure of European security, or just to be a neutral country and continue this traditional way of playing the special role. That depends on your general design, including economic aspects of all this operation. But I think it's clear that Lilia very correctly emphasized the red line, that Putin and his team just, they're looking for the red line and they're trying to test waters. Georgia was one point. You remember that Sarkozy at that time was chair of European Union, that developed the peaceful plan of Georgia. None of the points Putin implemented, but 3 months after, the whole West came back to Putin with the business as usual. Putin decided, yeah, that's the way how just the West allow me to behave. That's what the consequences we have, annexation of Crimea and aggression in eastern Ukraine. If we don't stop the aggressor there, just Transnistria, the next step, that's already preparation go there. Just public opinion already in Moldova too. Not only in Transnistria, but the whole Moldova. If it goes further on, then of course Article 5 goes as a next testing operation. But some people, for instance, Patrushev, who is the Secretary of Security Council, already said in an interview that we should in advance to occupy Baltic states so that not to allow Americans to install the operation there. That's what how just they're already keeping the water boiling on around this. That's why Ukraine, that's the most important point right now, talking about the whole architecture of European security. Syria, that is a victory for Putin, just to raise legitimacy and to demonstrate and interpret it, convert this victory and a great victory that only two superpower, the US and Russia, him, Putin. Ukraine, that is a really testing point. And as it was correctly said today, that if there is a success story, that the collapse of Putin's regime would be much closer. Mm-hmm. With the all combination of factors we already have, that will be another circumstance. That's why that's important to keep European unity, and very important to have transatlantic unity and to be consistent on what those policies which were developed. And I'd like to believe that president-elect and new president would realize that and continue to do this.
Thank you. Karin, NATO.
Since we're not a member, we cannot be that critical, I think, towards the organization. Yes, you can see that NATO is in some regards weak. On the other hand, that's the organization that we have, and we should try to support it and as soon as possible try to not just hope for some assistance if needed, and also to raise the guard, or raise the price for any kind of aggression. But I do agree. I also fear some kind of testing, as I already said, and I don't foresee a conventional military attack. I think it would turn out and unfold as just as Lilia said. It's unclear. It's not war. It's something else.
And us. This is not us.
No, of course not. No, I was just on vacation or something like that, having a leave of absence. So, of course, okay. This unclear, this kinds of gray zones, we've been talking about them for several years now, but it's more and more clear that I think, as I said, the tools are many, and you can almost play them like a piano or so, use the right keys when you need. On the other hand, If we look into a more the long term, it's now really difficult to see a sustainable kind of positive economical and demographical development inside the country. So it's as we see it, at least, it's not sustainable. Yeah. And with our population, it wouldn't be sustainable even for a couple of weeks. But we know that this is a really, really tough people. But there must be a limit, because in economical terms, it's not sustainable at all.
To add on NATO, to demonstrate what Putin's attitude to that. After the tragedy in 9/11 in the United States, that was 2001, and that time we, Russia, and NATO started the joint operation in Afghanistan. We are not on the ground with the boots on the ground, but with all those logistics, etc. That was the international coalition fighting with terrorism. And at that time, me, at that time being a prime minister, and I publicly said, I dream my country would be soon a full-fledged member of NATO, because the level of trust was so high. And we built up a special committee that was new stage of cooperation between Russia and NATO, the committee, NATO-Russia committee. Putin, in a softer way, but also said at that time, I don't exclude that Russia could be a member of NATO. What happened since that time? What the West made wrong in terms of Russia? Why the whole things just converted in different manner? And Putin started to say, just we making enlargement, etc., etc. That's what I'm saying. Just there is no permanent ideology on this way. Just the whole things around and externally, that's about just power inside Russia.
Jan, you've got a question in the back. And then, Jonathan, if you could give the microphone to the gentleman in the fourth row. We've got a question here, too, right up here. Yes, sir. Yes. Okay. What are the signs, Ilya, Lilia? Who wants to take a shot?
I will start. What are the signs? I will start. You know, we Russians like to help the others. You know, especially the rest of the world. We cannot help ourselves, but well, just only ask us to help, and maybe
to the last drop of blood of those who are being helped.
Well, look at the firstly, there are too many tipping points. And of course, Prime Minister Kasyanov and the deputy of the State Duma that were dealing with the Russian budget, with the Russian security issues, and with the rest will give you their specific answers. But firstly, the economic performance, the situation with the budget, the protest polling, the situation in Moscow, the irrationality within the Kremlin, the growth of the power structures, Siloviki power structures role. And we can go ahead with a list of tipping points. Everything will be relevant. And anything could happen. Just Crimea happened without any kind of tipping points. So you have to have funded institutions that will be monitoring the situation in Russia plus and in the whole former Soviet space. But maybe you'll add to the list of tipping points.
No, I agree that there should not be any specific tipping point, but the worse Russian people live, the bigger the chance of any kind of new aggression. And here we had a lot of disputes on the sanctions, for example, and we are basically now a type of Zugzwang situation. To lift the sanctions means to give Putin signal that he is victorious and allow him to put this in the Russian propaganda to stay with the sanctions as they are right now means to deeply alienate Russian people with the West, because it allows Putin to actually attribute all the economic difficulties not of the failure and misbehavior of its own government, but on the actions of the West. That's what was happening during last 2 years. And that's why I think that it's a way wiser approach to significantly expand personal sanctions and to chase Russian criminals at power in European Union and in United States and in other places where they launder their money, which are being stolen from Russian people. But discontinue with economic sanctions. And the perfect, tipping point, so to say, for this were recent elections in the State Duma. In the current State Duma, more than half of its members were elected on the territory of Crimea, the occupied territory, and according to all international norms, that suggests that this parliament should never be acknowledged as a legitimate parliament. And that's a perfect starting point to declare those deputies of this parliament as people who are supporting the occupation and put them on the sanction list. It's already a significant part of Russian elite, which represent a lot of financial groups in Russia. And that's what Russian elite really genuinely afraid of. And unfortunately, nothing like this has ever been done by the West. Be consistent and you will be safe.
We had, sir, you had a question here in the fourth row. No? Okay. Then in the back, we'll take you. Yes.
Discussion about Russia as a part of Western civilization, especially that story about how close Russia was to the West in the time of Mikhail Mikhailovich, Prime Minister time, inspired my question. So if we will go into the origin of current Russian regime, we will see that it was built firstly in 1993 when it was a bloody governmental coup in Moscow. And all great powers in the world supported and recognized it as a democratic step to the brilliant future. Swedish Prime Minister Carl Bildt, for example, he said to Parliament that we should support that democratic struggle against the communist reaction. And thousands of people were killed that night in the biggest European city. Then, 1996, it was the first big falsification of election, when President Yeltsin formally win under the communist candidate, and President Medvedev said that all we knew who really win. And then no one big country, no one democratic country criticized Russia's special way to democracy. And then it was truth when in the beginning of Putin rule, Russia was facing the applaud from all West. It became a legitimate part of that liberal developing of that global fight against terrorism. It gave the first time in a 500 years a place for foreign military base in Ulyanovsk, and the American plans bomb Afghanian villages from Russian territory. Question is, don't you really think that what had happened, that what we have now in Russia, is just legitimate result and obvious result of that general evolution of the liberal world? what we are talking about aggression.
So,
was only Russia aggressor in the last 10 years or last 15 years in war?
Okay, so that's your question?
Yes, this is my question. And include all that, with all the problems with national
что это такое? Почему? Что это такое? I mean, come on.
Don't you think that Russia is just...
Это ваш друг. I will let you take it. I will let you take it. Okay. Ilya, пожалуйста. Это ваш друг.
Yes. Alexei, I think that what you said about 1993, 1996 is totally true. And I also share this opinion that what is happening right now in Russia was pre-programmed at that time. And we are living at the constitution, which has a very dubious degree of legitimacy, and which pre-programmed the role of the president as a tsar, which is above all branches of power. And that was done for pure economic reasons, to ensure power of Boris Yeltsin and the reforms in the country. That's all true. The question is that we all were driven maybe for good intentions, and at that time it was seen as Russia really is trying to reform, and maybe it's inconsistent, maybe you know, it's making mistakes, but nevertheless it was the reforms. I think that's the lesson that we have to derive from this. And so I very much afraid that the West is now repeating the same mistake in Ukraine. It applies dual standards for different people. For some people who are seen as reformers, it's one set of standards. For another set of people who are seen as conservative, is another set of standards. And I think that if we want Russia to change, if we want Ukraine to change, if we want us all together to be successful, that we need to stand on one coherent and, most important, honest position about our values.
Thank you. Okay, was there a question in the back? Yes, sir, please. Right here in the back. Yes, thank you, Jonathan. Okay, who wants to...
Who's coming to power?
You know, in politics can't happen just this yes or no. Of course, I always just mention in my public speeches that both in terms of Georgia and Ukraine, we immediately start negotiations on restoring the order. Russian authority destroyed international law, international order, and the whole structure of security. And that's why everything should be immediately with the elected government of those countries just negotiated, including Crimea, including Abkhazia, Ossetia, etc. What will be result, outcome of those negotiations? That's what you understand, just the way we're approaching this. That there was a recognized territory, and moreover, Russia as a permanent member of Security Council just, of course, should defend the territorial integrity of both countries, Georgia and Ukraine. In Ukraine, even more, there is a special agreement when Russia has a special obligations together with the United States and Great Britain to restore, to defend territorial integrity of Ukraine. Same applies to Georgia. That's why that is the basic approach for those negotiations with the legitimate governments of those countries.
We've got a question on the right, on the aisle, right here.
Yes, thank you. Pat Holbeck, a member of the Moderate Party. Economics. I was listening about half a year ago to Swedish economist Anders Åslund.
Oh.
I guess it's pretty well known to many people here.
Yes.
And he was speaking about the status of the Russian economy. And very, very short, his analysis was that all the variables which directly impact the government, so public debt, foreign currency reserve, etc., are being prioritized. And all the variables which affect ordinary people, so real income, for instance, are being deprioritized. And his analysis was essentially that this policy mix, to this extent, has only been tried once before. That was Nicola Ceausescu in 1989. we all know where that ended up, so to say. Will you share this assessment, first of all? And if so, where would it end, so to say? I mean, this is...
Uh-huh. Well, we had a very robust debate with Anders and Mikhail in Visby on this very issue about how long will the cash reserves remain? When will they run out? When will Russia finally be reduced to asking for foreign assistance? And that's a very good question. So we'll start with you, Mikhail, on this.
Right. And on economy, just Anders always just described this in a way, just very, I would say, eatable manner. Of course, just there is a feeling, those people who follow just economic developments, the major feeling is that Putin believes or considers the whole economy and the whole state finances his. That's why he behaved this way and making such a statement, and you're using a Russian language, such a language, with the being close to those people whom we, I don't know what the world just to find as a friends operation, something like that. And of course, just a majority or almost all flaws of state finance, state income, under control of his friends. But in a direct application of the word privatization, privatized, of course it's not. But in general attitude and the structure which operates, I mean the whole political administrative structure, we can make such a conclusion what Anders did. Ceausescu, you said this, we have a long discussion how just what path we should choose. I mean, opposition and civil society. Today we also discussed it in private, also the many hours. But I think it's clear when Ilya saying maybe better to lift sanctions, and that will help Russian people to survive better. I would accept this as an inconsistent decision. What for? The circumstances which moved you to impose sanctions still in place. Why you should reconsidering your decision which you made 3 years ago? If nothing changed in this manner, you should continue to do this. And if the situation even worsening, maybe to even increase this pressure. Because you have your idea, you have your demand, and you would like to punish those people who destroyed the whole architecture of European security. Why it is allowed to Mr. Putin? Why you are going to issue a special ticket for him just to do whatever he wants? There is a system, there is a rule. Everyone living here should respect that. That's why I think that's absolutely okay. Moreover, those sectoral sanctions, they're applicable only to state corporations. State corporations in oil and gas sector and in finance. Private companies not under those sanctions. Of course, the whole environment is such that even private companies cannot raise the capital in the capital market. But formally, there is no such limitations. And your pressure on those sectors, it's pressure on Mr. Putin, because you're pressing the instruments which are in the hands of Mr. Putin, but not the Russian people. Putin grabbed this operation from Russian people. That's why you try to press on Mr. Putin. And in return, Mr. Putin said, no. Russia and Putin, that's the same. Putin and Russia, that's the same. That's why just we always call you in your discussions, always you should divide. That Russia doesn't mean Putin. Putin, it's with some with his supporters, that's one part, not necessarily the biggest part. But the ruling, what the policy that Mr. Putin pursues now, non-policy in economy, just of course inevitably leads to the collapse. That's why next year we see some changes. That's why there are such talks for about potential early elections of the president, mm-hmm. because just the resources, the funds, the reserves which the government has could be exhausted very soon. That's why it's important to implement promises already given, or to keep even the social contractual obligations that the government has right now, which they already are not capable to do. They already there are delays in the payment of wages in some regions of Russia. That's already the fact, and the whole budgets of regional budgets they with the great deficit, and the federal government even cannot even help them to do this. That's why they're cutting all expenditure. That's why they're cutting expenditure for investment, for local investment, and even the current expenditure to keep social infrastructure which belongs to the regional governments. They have not enough money. And schools and hospitals, that's, as you know, municipal responsibility. Mm-hmm. But what happened now, just Putin instructed so that the regional government would fund salaries of teachers and doctors, but hospitals as a material part are continued to be in municipal budget, but they have no money. And in the hospitals we don't have no medicine in the regions, and the whole disaster in the healthcare right now in Russia. And people realize that. That's why we're saying just the problems which would be very difficult to overcome for Mr. Putin, those problems coming very soon. That's why the whole pressure inside Russia and outside for this unacceptable regime for normal human being should change its policy. That's why we're dreaming to do this. We wanted to do this through constitutional manner as elections. There is no other way. Putin doesn't want the elections to be an instrument for changing the situation in Russia. That's why something else potentially could be. Maybe let's have a last test, presidential elections. But afterwards, what will happen? People would start waking up, not only middle class, what we had in Moscow and St. Petersburg in 2019, 2012. The people wanted just simply to say we demand respect of us, not more than that. But other people, not necessarily middle class, would come to the streets soon as pensions will not be paid on time, and as soon as wages will not be paid on time. And then it will be a completely different situation. That's what we'd like to avoid. That's why we're giving a signal to Mr. Putin. That's why it's important to have solidarity and continue our principled policy. So Putin would understand there is no soft pieces in all this front, including the United States.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
We've got a question here. Jan's on the aisle here, fourth row.
This is connected with the concrete position, political position of Minister Ulyukayev, because of privatization of Bashneft and upcoming privatization of Rosneft. That is the last resort what Mr. Putin has to privatize to get some money, to cover a growing deficit. And the privatization, instead of being, first of all, I object this privatization, because it's not time for such kind of privatization. There should be a normal change of policy. That's a different story. This I can make a lecture on that, but it's not a way how to survive in this period of time for the country. For Putin, maybe that's the case, just to have some money and to close the hole. But Ulyakayev took very very correct position. Privatization is the increased participation of private ownership in one or another enterprise. What Putin did, simply taken the state stake on one company and given, instead of budget and direct government operation, to the company controlled, which joint stock company controlled by his friend. And further on, they continue, they would like to have a borrowing from mother company. Just, it's difficult to explain, but the issue is it's not privatization. That's creating another gray areas of flow of money for his friends. Ulyakayev taken the position, principal position, it's not privatization, I don't want as a minister to sign up. And that's why I don't know what the circumstances they created, but I think they, it was artificially created circumstances, and they now press him as a criminal case. I don't know whether there was money given or not given. That was in, as I read today, it was in the office of Rosneft, etc., etc. I don't know what the actual atmosphere was there, but it's clear why it's appeared now, but not a year ago, because of position of this minister, who of course serves the Putin, and every 2 months saying, we're already on the bottom, we're jumping up, and the economy started to grow. 2 months after said, we continue to fall down. Just there is no bottom yet. but he continued to serve, but on that case, he taken the political principal position. I think that moved the power structures to make some kind of provocation. I'd like to believe that's really provocation, and Ulyakayev didn't take any bribe. I don't know.
Thank you. We have time for one more question. Who has a question? The lady in the back. Karin, since it's a Swedish question, Ilya.
It's to Karin.
Okay.
Well, I think I'm not in the best position to answer this. It must be you who would assess the possibility to really make any kind of difference. For me, the most important part is not to label which or give a name to a foreign policy, but of course the content and the firmness. And I must say I think we have had a quite firm standpoint since 2014, since the annexation of Crimea and the aggression in eastern Ukraine. So I think that was one of the questions that I had. What then could be a possible impact, or what is the best actions that Sweden can take? And for me, it's quite clear to be a part of the European Union. But it would be interesting to hear really your views on can we make a difference at all, or can we just sit here and hope and prepare ourselves for the worst?
Ilya?
Well, firstly, maybe we finally see a foreign policy with a human face, and that would be great. So, but speaking seriously, I think that any kind of involvement of foreign nations into Russian policies inside the country is counterproductive and will work against the objectives of a nation which is doing this. And definitely that would be against the interest of Russian opposition and Russian people altogether, because the result is at best unpredictable. If it is predictable, then it's negative. But that doesn't mean that nothing can be done, not at all. Firstly, I think that there is a great chunk of Russian diaspora, which is rapidly, unfortunately, growing recent years, after, especially after the annexation of Crimea in Western countries, especially in Europe and in the United States. And this is the most capable, most dynamic, most entrepreneurial, and most talented part of the society, with all its diversity and different political and other views. This is a great treasure. And I think it's our common interest to use this power, both brain and financial, by the way, power, to change the situation back home. That's the real lever, how we can transform Russia. And I think that currently foreign governments are neglecting the ways how this diaspora can be interacted with, the rare exceptions. There are certain exceptions, but usually it's not done sufficiently. Secondly, what I think is extremely important is to help Ukraine, because we need showcase. And so many Russians actually remember 90s and associate the failure of reform of 90s with the West. So right now we need to have a success. And Ukraine is so integrated with Russia. We have so many relatives which are living partly in one country and another country, so that no propaganda can hide where the success will happen, as well as no propaganda can hide the failure if that would happen. Right now, unfortunately, it's more towards failure, just another one, rather than for success. And I think that is that has to be a priority, if not a new Marshall Plan, but definitely a consistent and serious program of reforming Ukraine. And lastly, but not least, is that what we said before, to be consistent, that the words should match the deeds. One of the wise people in the United States once said to me that we Americans, we always advise others to do the opposite that we are doing ourselves. And actually what is happening in Ukraine reminds me very much of exactly that, because the advice that Ukrainians are getting is very much different how Americans dealt with their economy in the situation of their own crisis back several years ago. So I think if we will be honest, transparent, and we will be based on our values, then we'll be successful.
Mikhail, dva slova, two words, and then we'll have to wrap up.
Yeah, that's I agree what just Ilya described. Value-based policy, principled position, that's what we all would like to see our friends here in Europe take. Just not a trading, not a real politics, changes, exchanges, selling and buying something. Just there is a common ground for us. We are member of OECD, Sweden too. We are the member of Council of Europe. We all have our Charter of European Charter of Human Rights and Political Freedoms. We are all values written down there, and our Constitution too. That's why all our policies and decisions should be based on that. That's issue number one. And the circumstances what we have now, just inadequate regime in Russia, I think just there are some instruments which how you can help us. For instance, young people, to provide free places in universities here. and continue to have good relations with the civil society organizations, human rights organizations, etc., so that people would feel, those people who devoted to democratic principles, that they are supported morally with our friends here in Europe. That's important thing. For us, for opposition, that's important, so that you would continue to read and demand from Russia implementation of Russia, our international obligations, written down at least in OEC basket number 3, human rights, political freedoms, and European Charter of Human Rights. If we are the same Europeans, you should treat us as normal Europeans, not to close eyes on our misdeeds. Same as you treat, for instance, French problems when they have something with the gypsy or whatever, just operation, or in Slovakia or in Hungary. Why you are closing your eyes of some misdeeds of Putin's regime in Russia? You should continue to criticize for that, because that's our basis. Putin doesn't have a special right to interpret those international obligations in the manner he wants. That's the rule, and you should follow that. That a principal position would be always honored by at least 30% of Russians who an active position pro-European.
Thank you. Thank you. And I think that's a great note to end our presentation, our program. I'd like to thank, ladies and gentlemen, all of you for turning out to participate, to join us and to participate in what I think you'll agree was a very strong and productive discussion. And finally, I'd like to ask the audience to join me in acknowledging and thanking our panelists for a great job.